represents this unabridged recording of The Silent Invasion, The Change Trilogy, Book 1, written by James Bradley and read by Stephanie Foxley. For Annabelle and Lila. When I look back, it sometimes seems as if it all happened to somebody else, which in a sense it did. I left behind the me that was there, the me that did all those things long ago. Perhaps that other self is still out there, somewhere across that impossible distance of space and time. Perhaps she even thinks of me, here on this alien beach, under a sky so full of stars that even the night shines. Or perhaps she is gone, swept away like all the others. All I know is that sometimes, when I dream, I feel like all those other versions of me I have left scattered across the stars are moving just out of reach, as if we are remembering each other back into being. There was a time when I used to worry about who I was, about whether I was real anymore, or whether I was simply a copy of a copy. In those moments, it was difficult to know whether I was her, whether she was me. But perhaps I was asking the wrong question. Perhaps nobody ever feels real. Perhaps we all fall through life looking for those instants of connection that anchor us. Perhaps who we are is never set, but a process of becoming, in which we invent ourselves over and over again. I once thought love was about giving yourself over to something, about losing yourself. Yet I've done that. Lost myself in something larger. And it's not like love. Love is not about losing yourself, but about finding it, about allowing somebody else to know you. And even when you're in it, that place where it's difficult to know where you end and they begin, when all you want is to lose yourself in the thing you're making together. You know you'll find your way back, that they will lead you. Love isn't about surrendering yourself. It's about being connected through space and time to others who know you and care for you and will help you be. Sometimes those connections are ones we make every day, worn smooth by proximity. Sometimes they are more distant, connections of memory that bind us to those we have left behind. Yet either way, we are all caught in a web of connection to the living and the dead, and the yet-to-be born. A web of memory and forgetting that connects past to present to future, in which each of us is forever becoming and passing away. This is what makes us real, even if, as I have, we travel so far we leave almost all of it behind. And at the same time, we are made real by the fact we too will pass in time. I know this because I have been both. I have been part of a whole spread across space, stretching endlessly back through time and onto the horizon of the future. And I have been alone, or thought myself alone, only to discover I'm still connected, that I bear them in me and always will, just as they will bear me in them, onward into the light. 1. I was at the bike racks outside school when my stepmother Vanessa messaged me. Gracie has wandered off again. At first I considered ignoring her. It was already after 5 and I'd had a crappy day. But I knew she'd just keep messaging if I didn't reply. Not in her room? Not in house? I buckled my helmet and yanked my bike from the rack while I thought about what to do. Okay, we'll find her. As I accelerated down the drive towards the school gates, I imagined how satisfying it would be to just ignore Vanessa's request. For as long as I could remember, she had treated me like an unpaid nanny or live-in babysitter, able to be called on to look after Gracie whenever she was busy or she and my stepfather Tim needed help. But no matter how much I did, it was never quite enough to be treated like one of the family. In Vanessa's eyes, I was always an outsider, an inconvenience. It had been particularly bad since Casper was born, but the truth was, Vanessa and I never really clicked. Even when Dad was still around, she had always spoken to me with the false brightness people use to stop themselves having to actually talk to kids. To be fair, she was a bit like that with Gracie and Casper as well. But it was different with them. Even if she talked to them in her prattling baby voice, she was still their mother, and there was never any question she loved them. Outside the school, I turned left down a side road. Although the back way took longer, most days for the past few weeks there had been roadblocks and random scanning stations set up on the main road, which were at best a hassle and sometimes worse. A few days earlier, quarantine had pulled a black-clad woman out of the line in front of me, dragging her away while her husband shouted desperately and their two kids bawled, an experience I wasn't in a hurry to repeat. The afternoon sun was hot on my back and shoulders as I cranked up the hill. Adelaide spread out across the plain below. I knew where Gracie was, of course. She had always loved the patch of bush at the end of our street, and was never happier playing by the old dam that lay a little further down the hill. She was unusual like that. Most people, even kids, were so paranoid about contamination they avoided places where plants grew wild. But for Gracie, such places had always held a special fascination. Still, I was a little surprised she'd snuck off. When I'd left home, she'd been complaining she didn't feel well. I didn't know what had happened after that, but it was clear Vanessa had agreed to let her stay home. It struck me as odd, because although she was still in her first year, Gracie liked school and wouldn't usually have stayed home unless she really was sick. Yet somehow she had recovered enough to slip out by the afternoon, which suggested she hadn't been all that sick to start with. It was quiet as I bumped my bike down the track towards the dam. Stopping by the water, I laid my bike down under one of the trees and called her name. But there was no reply. I glanced around, beginning to wonder whether I was mistaken, and she was somewhere else entirely. But just as I was drawing breath to call out again, I spotted her beneath an old gum on the far side of the dam. I walked towards her slowly. She had her back to me and was immersed in some kind of game. In one hand she was clutching her bunny, his bedraggled fur even dirtier than normal. In the other, a small stone she seemed to be explaining something to Bunny about. She was so absorbed, she didn't notice me, not even when I stopped on the bank just behind her and stood, smiling. Although I loved watching her grow, there were times I wished she could stay like this forever. "Geez, Gracie," I said at last. "Vanessa said you snuck out without telling her." She turned with a start and stared up at me, the expression on her face telling me what I already suspected. She'd been unhappy in some way. That wasn't surprising. In the months since Casper had been born, Vanessa hadn't found much time to be with Gracie or give her the attention she needed. She looked down again. "Sorry," she said in a small voice. I sat down next to her and brushed a curl off her face. "It's okay," I said. "Are you feeling better?" She shrugged, and I smiled despite myself. Growing up without Dad, with only the two of us, had made it difficult for me to stay angry with her.
"I suppose."
"What was it? An allergy to school?" Gracie gave me a look and poked her stick into the ground.
"I don't know," she said. "I feel weird."
Definitely a case of school allergy then, I said. Probably terminal. She pulled away from me, pretending to be annoyed. I touched her forehead. Even in the heat, it felt surprisingly warm. Have you got a fever? She shrugged. Here, I said, standing her up so I could look at her. Stick out your tongue. As she stuck out her tongue, she closed her eyes, and all at once I felt a fierce love for her. It wasn't fair she should miss out because of Casper. Gracie deserved better than to be a second choice, the leftover from Vanessa's first marriage. I took a deep breath. Throat looks all right, I said, then poked her in the tummy so she doubled over laughing. What about these dirty hands? As I spoke, I turned her hands over in mine, thinking to tickle her. But as I did, I caught sight of the underside of her arm and froze. She stopped laughing and looked at me. What? She asked, still smiling. I didn't answer. What? She asked again, and this time I managed to tear my eyes away from her arm and look at her.
It's nothing, I said weakly. I just remembered something.
Remembered what?
It doesn't matter, I said, standing up. Come on, we have to get home.
Vanessa was waiting by the door as I approached, Gracie beside me. The lights were on, and through the doorway I could see the screen was on and hear Casper howling in his room.
Oh, thank God, she said, stepping down and coming towards us. Is she all right?
She's fine, I said, more sharply than I intended. Just tired.
Vanessa smoothed Gracie's hair away to look at her face. I tensed, willing myself not to knock her hand away.
Where was she?
I glanced over my shoulder.
Down by the dam.
Vanessa was about to say something when the intensity of Casper's howling shifted up a notch.
Don't worry, I said. I'll get her to bed.
Doesn't she want dinner?
I looked at Gracie, who shrugged.
I'm not hungry.
Vanessa nodded.
Thanks, Callie, she said.
I watched her disappear up the hall into Casper's room. When I was sure she was gone, I picked Gracie up and carried her up the stairs to our bedroom. As usual, its low-ceilinged space was hot and airless, the windows sealed against the outside. I pushed the door shut with my back and sat Gracie on the side of the bed. Working quickly, I drew her dress over her head and wriggled her into her nightie. She didn't resist. Not even when I laid her down on the bed and drew the sheet up over her.
You okay? I asked,
and she nodded. I touched her cheek and sat back on my bed.
Good night, Callie,
she said, looking at me over her sheet.
Good night, Gracie, I replied.
I leaned back against the wall watching her, and only when her breathing had slowed and I knew she was asleep, did I look up and, fighting back tears, let out a long, juddering sigh, because Gracie had begun to change. 2. It was after 9 before I heard Tim arrive home. Casper had finally stopped crying and Vanessa was in the kitchen. On her bed, Gracie was asleep, her back turned to me. From where I sat, the slight phosphor on her arms and legs was hidden, yet I knew it was there, and it terrified me. When she was younger, I'd lie next to her as she slept just so I could feel connected to her, connected to anybody. Now I was almost afraid to go near her. I didn't know where she had been infected or when. Perhaps it had been a spore borne south on the wind from the zone. Perhaps there was an outbreak of changed plants somewhere nearby, growing wild by a roadside or under a house. Despite quarantine's efforts, changed biology was everywhere. What I did know was what would happen next. As the change took hold of her, the soft glow dusting on her skin would spread, gradually covering her hands and face and scattering motes in her eyes until they turned gold and green,
light moving within them as it does in those of a cat. Yet the phosphor was only the outward sign of another more profound metamorphosis. For as the change spread through her system, it was bonding with her at a cellular level, rewriting her DNA, transforming her so she was no longer human. How long this process took depended on the individual. Sometimes it would be over in a matter of days, sometimes it might take weeks. But when it was complete, Gracie would be gone. For as the change remade her body, it was also altering her mind, meaning that as she changed, Gracie would begin to disappear. Her memories, her intellect, her very self supplanted by something else, something alien and unknowable, something other. In the 10 years since the change arrived, so many had been infected it was impossible to keep track of the true numbers of those lost or taken by quarantine. Every week another empty seat at school, another teacher missing, another house left abandoned or child found wandering without their parents. Every week another face pinned to the walls where people placed pictures of the vanished in the hope somebody might know what had happened to them. In this I was lucky, I suppose. 5 years earlier when my father changed, I had been there when quarantine came, had seen them take him. So I knew what had happened to him, even if the thought of his absence still ached inside of me. Yet when I looked at Gracie, I could hardly believe it was happening again. I was going to lose her as well. Who was I without her? I knew I had to turn her in, and that even if I didn't, as soon as Vanessa or Tim noticed the symptoms, they would have no choice but to do it themselves. Yet still there was a part of me that kept hoping I'd made some kind of mistake, or that somehow it would be different with Gracie, and she wouldn't change, or wouldn't change completely, or that I might be able to convince Vanessa and Tim to keep her or hide her. Anything that meant this wasn't what I knew it was. But I also knew these fantasies were ridiculous. The penalties for not immediately reporting the change were huge. I could be arrested for helping Gracie or hiding her. I could even be arrested for having brought her home instead of calling quarantine as soon as I noticed the symptoms of the change. I couldn't even start reading about it online without attracting the attention of one of quarantine's snooper systems. Outside, the wind was getting up, and I could hear the trees shifting about. Downstairs, Tim and Vanessa were moving around, probably getting ready for bed. Across the room, Gracie was snoring softly. The sound so weirdly normal, it was hard to believe it might be the last time I heard it, that this might be the last time we were together. The thought was so terrible, I went and sat down beside her. This close, she looked like she always did, her dark hair messy, her face dusted with freckles. Reaching out, I touched her cheek, felt the warmth of her. Then, slipping in beside her, I pressed my face into her neck. And as I did, something in me snapped, and tears came, sudden and unexpected. I woke early. Beside me, Gracie was still asleep, her face turned away towards the wall. I touched her forehead. She was warm, slightly feverish. Lifting her sleeve, I looked at the underside of her arm and saw the shimmer of the change, the knowledge it was real settling like a dead weight on my chest. Pulling on a t-shirt and shorts, I looked out the door. I couldn't risk going into the shower in case Gracie woke up and Vanessa came in and dressed her. There was movement behind me. Turning, I found Gracie sitting on the bed watching me. I tried to smile. "Hey, Gracie," I said. She made a face. "I'm hot," she said. I nodded. "I know, sweetie. Where's Mummy?" I glanced at the door. "She's busy with Casper. I thought we might go somewhere today, though." "What about school?" I shrugged. "I thought we'd have a day off." Gracie stared at me in her serious way. I thought she was going to object, But then she just nodded.
Okay.
I really don't know what I was planning to do. I think I thought that if we got away for the day, I might come up with a plan, or something miraculous might happen, that Gracie might suddenly get better. But there was another part of me that simply wanted one more day with her before they took her away from me. A day when we could be together. A day when she was happy. Tim was in the shower and Vanessa was with Casper in his room, so I sat Gracie at the table and put her breakfast in front of her. The glimmer of the change didn't seem to have worsened overnight, so it was unlikely anybody would notice anything as long as I kept her dress done up. Most kids are difficult about food, but Gracie was never like that. There were things she ate and things she didn't, and if you offered her something she hadn't tried before, she would look at it seriously, taste it, and either continue or put it aside. Drama just wasn't her thing, which was good, because it meant that by the time Vanessa appeared with Casper on her hip, Gracie was eating quietly. Vanessa kissed Gracie on the head, but Gracie focused on her breakfast, didn't look up.
"She's feeling better?" Vanessa asked me.
"I think so," I said, a little too quickly.
"Good," Vanessa said.
"How's Casper?" I asked, aware even as I spoke that I sounded uncomfortable. Vanessa glanced at me. She looked exhausted, her face haggard with lack of sleep.
"Fine," she said.
But before she could say anything else, Tim appeared in the doorway.
"Have you seen my blue shirt?" he asked.
Vanessa looked around.
"Have you tried the laundry?"
"It's not there."
Vanessa shook her head. "Hang on," she said, pushing past him. As if noticing me for the first time, Tim nodded in my direction.
"Hi, Callie,"
he said, before turning to follow her. Opposite me, Gracie had almost finished her breakfast.
"Come on," I said, taking her hand. "Let's go."
Although it was still cool in the shade, you could smell the approaching heat in the air. Two houses along, the Ayers kids were coming down their drive. I stopped for a few seconds to let them get ahead of us, then pulled Gracie in the opposite direction.
"Come on," I said.
We made our way quickly toward the trees at the end of the street. As we passed the old playground that stood beside the last house, Gracie hesitated.
"I want to play for a while," she said.
"Not now," I said. "We need to keep moving."
"Why?"
I glanced back up the street. Tim would be leaving for work soon, and I didn't want him to catch us standing there.
"Just because?"
The street followed the line of the hill, and at its end, where it met the bush, two paths ran off in different directions. The first headed upward and back along the rear fences of the houses along our side of the street. The other downward through a line of trees towards the dam where I had found Gracie the day before. We took the second, winding out along the side of the dam and then on beside the creek. I knew this path well. For the first year or so after Dad changed, I stayed with Vanessa in the house where Dad and I had lived before he met her. It was the only house I had ever known, and although after Mum died, it was just me and Dad, it was home. Once he was gone, it was different, yet somehow being there still helped. But when Vanessa met Tim, they wanted somewhere new, somewhere that wasn't the place Vanessa had shared with Dad, and wasn't so close to the city and the refugee camps, and so they moved up here into the hills. At first, I hated it. Hated everything about it, the heat, the quiet, the other kids. I was so angry, I couldn't see that what I really hated was leaving our other house and life without Dad. If it hadn't been for Gracie, who was little more than a baby then, I think I would have run away. Gone into the city or to one of the camps, anywhere but here. But I knew I couldn't leave Gracie, so instead I began to escape out into the bush whenever I could. A kilometre or so along the track, the creek drained into a concrete culvert, and I used to sit on the side and look at the water as it trickled by. Then, one day, a few months after we moved here, I had an argument with Vanessa. I don't remember what it was about, but whatever it was enough to send me running out of the house and down toward the creek. I wanted to be alone. But more than that, I needed to be in motion, to lose myself in the ache of my muscles, the burning of my breath in my chest. I must have run for half an hour or even longer, my feet slipping on the loose ground as I pelted through the trees and the bushes that grew along the line of the creek, until eventually the land began to flatten out, the bush giving way to the back fence of a house. It was small, built out of orange bricks with a red-tiled roof. And although the fence was still standing, I could see from the long grass and broken furniture in the backyard that it was unoccupied. I was old enough to know it wasn't safe to go poking through abandoned houses, but as I stood looking at the yard choked with weeds and the back door that stood half open, something came over me, and with sudden determination I clambered over the fence and crossed the yard to the house. Inside it was dark, the air thick with the smell of mold and decay. Looking around, I could see I wasn't the first person to come here. The shelves had been stripped, and somebody had sprayed dye, dye, dye on one of the walls in black paint. But despite that, there were still signs of the people who had once lived here. On one wall hung a row of framed photos, images of a family, a mother, a father, two children. They weren't doing anything special. In one, a boy stood on the pedals of a bike, his face turned to the camera as he pulled a face. In another, they sat in a line on a beach, yet I was struck by the wastefulness of it all. Where were they now? Were any of them alive? Had they changed? Or had something else happened to them, something worse? I saw a chair, suddenly furious. I kicked at it, then I picked up a book and threw it, then another, before finally grabbing the shelf and tipping it over. Only when I was done did I realize I was crying. I still don't know what set me off that day, whether it was the fight with Vanessa, or feeling like I'd lost my home, or simply the fact that Dad was gone. But afterwards, as I made my way back, I understood I'd come to the end of something, and if I was going to keep going, I needed to let go. In the 3 years since then, I'd got good at keeping everything I felt hidden away. But now, with Gracie, I wasn't sure I could manage it any longer. I wasn't sure what I'd do if they took her as well. By the time we reached the creek, Gracie was walking ahead of me. She loved it down here, loved the quiet and the space. Where most people saw a wasteland, she saw a place filled with wonders, frogs and lizards, fish, even wallabies and kangaroos, and the occasional fox. Sometimes I thought Gracie must have some sort of psychic connection to the landscape. Certainly I'd never known another kid who was better at finding things, at spotting nesting birds or animals poised, so still anybody else would have missed them. Ordinarily, I tried to guide her when we were down here, keep her moving on some semblance of the path I needed her to be on. But today I didn't try. Instead, I just let her go where she pleased. When she was walking, she was quiet, lost in whatever it was she was doing, and although I was busting to talk to her, I was afraid of what might happen if I tried to talk, and so I just kept my mouth shut. Finally, as lunchtime approached, we stopped in the shade of a pair of bushes. It was hot, and as we sat down, Gracie took my water bottle and drank. And when she was done, she picked up her bunny.
"I'm sick, aren't I?" she said.
I looked at her, shocked. When I didn't answer, she pulled her sleeve up, revealing the shimmer of the change on her skin.
"Will they take me away like Daddy?"
I hesitated, fighting back tears, then I nodded slowly.
"What will happen to me?"
"I don't know," I lied.
"Will they hurt me?"
I shook my head. "No," I said, hating myself for the ease with which I deceived her.
"Of course not." "Will I be allowed to see you?" she asked.
I shook my head. "No," I said in a small, strangled voice. Gracie nodded.
"Will Daddy be there when I get there?"
I don't think so, I said, but perhaps. She looked down at the ground.
I'm scared.
Oh, sweetie, I said in a rush, pulling her toward me.
I know, I said. So am I.
It was almost 4 by the time we arrived back at the road. Gracie was tired, and although she was heavy, I carried her up the hill to our street, so I was hot and my arms and legs ached. As we reached the playground, William and Lizzie Young came hurrying towards us. William and Lizzie were the heads of the local citizens' safety group, and I could tell from the gun on William's belt something was up.
Callie! Lizzie called as they approached. Thank God!
What? I asked.
We've been trying to ping you all afternoon.
I've had my phone off, I said. What's going on?
A group of men broke into the Hamers and attacked them, William said. We think they're still nearby. Here, he said. Give me Gracie.
As he spoke, he reached out and took hold of Gracie. Startled, I pulled away.
No,
I said, my voice louder than I had meant it to be. William hesitated, his hand still on Gracie. Lizzie stepped closer.
Come on, she said. We have to go.
We were walking next to each other now, Gracie between us. I pulled on her arm, trying to free her, but William didn't let go, and Gracie let out a cry. William released his grip, but as he did, I saw him glance downward and catch the underside of Gracie's arm protruding from her sleeve. He stopped dead, his eyes locked on Gracie's arm. Then he looked up at me.
What?
Lizzie began to ask, but then her voice trailed away.
Oh, no,
she said, her words barely audible.
Please,
I said, but neither of them answered. They just stood staring at me.
What do we do? Lizzie said.
For a few seconds, William didn't speak. Then he shook his head.
I'm sorry, Callie, he said, taking hold of Gracie again. This time, I didn't resist. Call quarantine, he said. I'll tell Vanessa and Tim.
Lizzie had gone pale.
No, I said, I can take her.
As I spoke, Gracie gave a cry and reached out to me. William backed away with Gracie in his arms.
You've done enough already,
he said, his voice telling me he was hating every second of this. I chased him up the slope, pleading with him to let her go. When we were halfway up, Tim and Vanessa appeared at the door above us. Vanessa was rocking Casper gently in her arms.
Gracie!
She shouted, pushing past Tim and hurrying towards us. But before she reached him, William turned aside. Vanessa stopped, confused.
What is it? She asked. What's wrong?
William didn't answer, just stood, Gracie in his arms, staring at Vanessa.
William, Vanessa said. Lizzie?
Vanessa, William said. Take Casper inside.
Vanessa shook her head.
I don't understand.
But as she spoke, I saw Tim had realized something was very wrong. Do as he says, he said.
No, Vanessa said, not until I know what's going on.
In her arms, Casper had begun to scream.
Please, Vanessa, Tim began.
But before he could finish, Vanessa saw Gracie's arm.
No,
she said, starting towards William and Gracie.
Gracie!
Tim grabbed her arm.
Vanessa, stop!
Still clutching Casper to her chest, Vanessa let Tim draw her back. Lizzie placed a hand on her shoulder and leaned in, saying something I couldn't hear. At first, Vanessa shook her head, but then Lizzie put an arm around her, and with a small nod, Vanessa allowed herself to be ushered back into the house.
We've got to get her inside until quarantine arrive, William said. It's not safe out here.
Tim didn't answer immediately, just stood staring at Gracie.
Tim, William said. Are you certain?
Tim asked.
It's not a mistake.
No, William said. And even if it is, quarantine can sort it out. For now we need to get her somewhere safe.
Tim nodded.
Bring her inside and put her in her room.
Above us, Lizzie had reappeared at the door. Take Callie to our place, he said, as she came towards us. She can wait there.
No, I said. I want to be with Gracie.
I don't think that's a good idea, William said.
Please, I said, my voice rising. I have to.
Lizzie took my arm, her grip firm. Stop this, Callie, she said. There's nothing you can do.
No, I said, shaking my head. They can't take her. It's not fair. It's not fair.
But even as I said it, something in me yielded to Lizzie's grip, to her attempt to pull me away. The last thing I saw was William watching me, his face not hard, not angry, but sad. Lizzie sat me down on the couch. I hadn't been in her and William's house before, and I couldn't help but notice how temporary it seemed. Furniture strewn here and there, boxes in the corners. I supposed it shouldn't have surprised me. After all, so many people were on the move, running from the change or trying to forget people they had lost. Lizzie disappeared into the kitchen and returned with a glass of water. Here, she said, handing it to me, careful to keep her distance. There was no reason to think I was infected as well. And even if I was, I wouldn't be infectious. But that didn't change how jumpy people got whenever there was an outbreak. I took the glass without speaking. She looked down at me with what I suppose was compassion. I need to know I can trust you not to do anything stupid if I leave you here. I nodded.
Okay.
Are you certain? We've got trouble outside and I need to be there.
Whatever you say,
I said more sharply this time. Lizzie stood watching me. Good, she said, then turned back to the door. And Callie?
What?
I can't imagine what you're going through. Once she was gone, I sat on the couch for a long time. I'd known since I saw the signs of the change yesterday afternoon that this was how it would end. But now I was here, it seemed impossible to bear. Nobody liked to talk about it, but we all knew what happened to the people quarantine took. When it wasn't us, when it wasn't somebody we knew, somebody we loved, it was possible not to think about it, or to tell ourselves it was what we needed to do to survive. But now it was Gracie. I wasn't sure I believed that anymore. Outside, somebody shouted William's name, the sound jolting me back into the moment. Because we were a little way out of the city, we didn't tend to get too much trouble. But most weeks there was some kind of break-in or incident. Usually they were just people from up north looking for somewhere to sleep or something to eat, but sometimes they got ugly. I knew Tim thought we needed to be harder about it all, that a few shots in the air never hurt, so I was glad he wasn't out there tonight. After a while, I realized I was still holding my glass. Leaning over, I put it down, but as I did, I received a call. I picked up and Vanessa started speaking without even drawing breath.
When did it happen, Callie? When did you notice?
Yesterday, I said.
And you let her stay here with Casper?
I didn't answer.
He could have caught it.
It's not contagious like that, you know that.
Perhaps not in adults, but who knows with babies? And anyway, what if quarantine found out? We could have been arrested.
She paused.
Is she still there?
I asked abruptly. Is she okay?
Yes, Vanessa said, her voice faltering. Yes, oh God, Callie, they're going to take her away.
I nodded, tears coming again.
I want to see her.
She sniffed.
No,
she said.
It's not safe. Please, I have to, I said.
But before I could continue, Tim's voice appeared on the line.
Just stay there, Callie, he said. There's nothing to be done.
Then the line went dead and I was alone. The thing they don't tell you about grief is that no matter how bad the shock is, the part that comes afterwards, when you face the idea of life without the person you have lost, is worse. Because it's then that you're most alone. Sometimes I think that time never ends. That you're never without that empty space inside you. But either way, I'm not sure I could have made it through the weeks and months after Dad changed if it hadn't been for Claire. Claire was my father's oldest friend. They had met when he first came to Australia from Nigeria to do his doctorate. And at first, both had simply been pleased to discover somebody with similar interests and shared a fascination with speculative biology. But over the years, they had become friends, then colleagues, and even for a year or two, when I was 5 or 6, lovers. That hadn't worked out,
but they had, perhaps surprisingly, remained close, even after he met Vanessa. Losing Dad must have been hard for Claire as well, but she never showed it. Right from the beginning, she kept dropping in, helping me get to school, doing what needed to be done. What was great about Claire was the fact she didn't seem to think I was crazy for being so angry or for not wanting to accept he was gone. "It isn't fair," she said, "any of it. Not for you, not for him, not for anyone." One day I asked her something. We'd been somewhere together, in the park, I think, and we were walking back to Vanessa's apartment. "Why couldn't we have just gone somewhere and hidden?" I asked. Claire touched my head, smoothing down my hair. "Because they'd find you," she said. "No matter where we went?" She nodded, and then she looked away. One of the other things I liked about Claire was the way she treated me like an equal instead of a kid. Sensing her hesitation, I looked up. "So there is somewhere we could have gone." She looked at me. "Some people run, Callie. Try to make it to the zone." It wasn't the first time I'd heard of people running, heading north towards the exclusion zone that lay beyond what was once the Queensland border in an attempt to escape capture. It made sense after all, although the exclusion zones that circled the world's equatorial and subtropical regions had been established to keep the rest of us safe by containing the change. Isolating its biology from the rest of the planet, they also offered a place of potential refuge. "Would he have been safe there?" Claire shook her head. "I don't know." "Then why do it?" She shrugged. "Because quarantine won't follow you there, because it's better than being dead. Because when you've got no other options, even the worst option begins to look good." Seated there on William and Lizzie's couch, I found myself remembering Claire's words. And as I did, I knew what I had to do. 3. Dusk was gathering as I slipped out the back door of William and Lizzie's house, the sky fading toward dark. Their backyard was as temporary as the inside, a pair of bikes leaning against the building, a disused barbecue by the wall, a few boxes piled under the eaves. Standing there, it was difficult not to be struck by how quiet it was. Normally at this time of night, you would hear some of the kids in the street shouting, sometimes the sound of music or a scream, but tonight there was nothing. Keeping low, I headed down the side of the house towards the street, relieved to see that William and Lizzie and the others were gone, no doubt looking for whoever had broken into the Hamers. I didn't really have a plan. All I knew was that I had to get Gracie somewhere safe before quarantine arrived. I looked up at the sky. Overhead, a few stars were already visible against the high cloud, and a point of light moved quickly, a satellite, or perhaps the old space station, Janus. There was too much light for me to risk the street. So moving quickly and quietly, I went back up the side and ran down the path by the back fences. When I reached the back fence, I leaned against it and took a breath, attempting to prepare myself for what was to come. Images of what might go wrong kept going through my mind. What if Tim caught me and tried to stop me? What if quarantine turned up as I was trying to get away? The whole idea was crazy, I knew that. I slipped quietly past the back of the garage and over to the doors that opened onto the patio. Inside, I could see Vanessa seated at the table, Tim beside her. Although her face was turned away from me, I could tell she was weeping, that he was comforting her. As I watched, he said something and her shoulders convulsed. I willed myself to breathe, to be calm. Then, hoping neither of them happened to glance around, I shot past the sliding doors to the far side of the house and the laundry door. There wasn't much up here, the spare water tank, a hose, and a space for drying clothes. During the daytime, when Vanessa was in and out all the time with washing for Casper, the door was usually unlocked, and as I turned the handle, I was relieved to find it was unlocked now. The house was quiet save for the sound of Casper humming to himself out the back. Did any of this mean anything to him, I wondered,
Would he even remember Gracie and me? Probably not. Probably we'd just be a story. An absence he accepted as he grew older. He yipped suddenly and I felt tears well up and fought them down. Taking a deep breath to steady myself, I headed up the stairs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.